Bond fans certainly can cherry-pick their favorites, but there's really only one way to view these adventures as the work of one semi-ageless operative, and it's not in chronological order. You've been watching James Bond movies all wrong, and here's why. To start at the character's beginning means 2006's Casino Royale, the franchise reboot that served as Daniel Craig's Bond debut. Based on Fleming's first Bond novel, the film gives Bond a gritty origin story in which he earns his 00 status, drives off with his signature Aston Martin, and uses his brawn as well as his wits, like when he flings an empty handgun right back in an opponent's face. Most importantly, the film refreshes the trope of a woman who does him wrong by having a genuine love story with an unwilling betrayal. Ava Green's Treasury liaison Vesper Lynd throws real sparks with Craig, revealing a striking complexity beneath Bond's flinty gaze. Phoebe Waller-Bridge, the Fleabag star and co-screenwriter of No Time to Die, told GQ, "He let us in a bit, which makes the moment he shuts us out even more arresting. Overall, he grounded a fantasy character in real emotion, which is what I think we hadn't realized we'd missed amongst the action and the bravado." Quantum of Solace, released in 2008, picks up where Casino Royale left off, with Bond discovering that criminal banker Le Chiffre is part of a larger terrorist organization called Quantum. He also ferrets out more about Vesper's past. Unfortunately, the Writers Guild strike at the time hampered a cohesive plot, with Craig admitting to GQ, "We didn't have a script, so we concentrated a lot on the stunts." Craig's third outing, Skyfall, continued to develop Bond as a character, particularly his relationship with M. After a botched mission with new agent Eve, Bond is presumed dead. But when vengeful ex-agent Raoul Silva targets M and MI6, Bond returns as M's protector, taking her to Skyfall, his childhood home in the Scottish Highlands. There, viewers see the headstones of his parents, and their surname confirms that James Bond is the same character across the franchise, admittedly one without much of a secret identity. Bond defeats Silva, but M dies, throwing off the continuity when Dench turns up in the Pierce Brosnan years. As much as the Craig films serve as Bond's origin story, 2015 Spectre also delves into his connection with the criminal organization, a frequent adversary from Fleming's novels. On the trail of Mr. White, a character from Casino Royale and Quantum of Solace, Bond learns that the Quantum organization is a Spectre subsidiary. He also meets White's daughter, psychologist Madeleine Swann. The two follow Spectre's trail to Morocco, where they wind up prisoners of a man Bond recognizes as Franz Oberhauser, son of a foster father from Bond's youth. Oberhauser reveals that his current name is Ernst Stavro Blofeld, which rings a bell for Bond aficionados. As Oberhauser, he'd faked his death, and now he's in charge of Spectre, which has an MI6 mole with designs on a global surveillance network. Of course, Bond foils Blofeld's plan, then drives off with Swan, leaving espionage behind. No Time to Die forces him back into the field as CIA pal Felix Leiter asks him for help in pursuing Safin, an anarchist and ex-Spectre assassin. Meanwhile, Blofeld stirs up trouble while in custody, and a secret from Swan's past surfaces. It's safe to assume that whatever else No Time to Die has in store, Bond's relationship with Swan won't survive. Dr. No, released in 1962, officially introduced moviegoers to Fleming's secret agent, along with the concept of the Bond girl and an eccentric, power-crazy villain. Sean Connery's Bond heads to Jamaica to investigate the slaying of another British agent, discovering that the death is connected to recent sabotage of the US space program. His investigation leads to a private island, where he encounters Honey Rider, a gorgeous diver searching for seashells. The two meet the island's owner, Dr. Julius No, a Spectre agent and nuclear scientist aiming to take over a US rocket launch as revenge for both the Americans and the East not recognizing his genius. Thanks to Bond, his plans end in a meltdown. Connery's follow-up, 1963's From Russia with Love, further explores Spectre and its nefarious plans as Bond goes undercover to meet Tatiana Romanova, a Russian cipher clerk wanting to defect with the decoder device. She turns out to be an unwitting pawn in a Spectre assassination plot against Bond for killing Dr. No. Bond strangles one Spectre assassin and goes toe-to-toe with another, wielding a poison spike in her shoe. Romanova comes to his defense, proving that love conquers all. Definitely one of the most memorable Bond films, Goldfinger finds Bond looking into Auric Goldfinger, a gold magnate who smuggles the stuff out of England through the bodywork of his Rolls-Royce. But Goldfinger has a grander scheme in mind. destroying the gold reserve in Fort Knox with an atomic bomb, rendering it useless and thus cementing his wealth. To enter Fort Knox, Goldfinger enlists an elite squad of female pilots to spray nerve gas, which will kill thousands. Bond wins over the improbably named squadron leader, Pussy Galore, before stopping the bomb with a precise 007 seconds to spare. Connery told the New York Times at the time, "It sort of demonstrates what I believe is a subtler, more discriminating Bond than you've seen in the earlier films. I guess I'm trying to make James Bond grow up a little, in the same way that I'm growing up myself. Not too much, though. Definitely not too much. That would spoil the fun for both of us." Thunderball, released in 1965, sends Bond to the Bahamas to recover two nuclear warheads that Emilio Largo, second-in-command at Spectre, hijacks for ransom. Swiping them involved brainwashing a pilot and sending him for plastic surgery, something Bond discovers while visiting a health spa for some R&R under M's orders. Eventually, Bond pieces together that the brainwashed pilot, whom Spectre kills, is the brother of Domino, Largo's mistress. You Only Live Twice, released in 1967, showed Connery's Bond at last meeting Spectre leader Ernst Stavro Blofeld. After an attempt on Bond's life, complete with a burial at sea, Bond re-emerges and joins forces with Tiger Tanaka of Japanese intelligence. Tanaka suggests that Bond marry to pose as a local fisherman so he can investigate undercover. The bride is another agent, Kissy Suzuki, who is all business. The two uncover a secret Spectre base within a volcano where Blofeld hoped to deceive the Soviets and Americans into starting World War III. With those plans thwarted, Kissy and Bond decide to enjoy their honeymoon until MI6 interrupts. Australian actor George Lazenby stepped into Bond's shoes in 1969's On Her Majesty's Secret Service. After he rescues the suicidal Contessa Tracy DiVincenzo from drowning in the opening moments, she drives away, leaving Bond dumbstruck and spurring theories of James Bond being a codename with a cheeky aside to the camera.
"This never happened to the other fella."
The espionage plot is a little kooky this time around, with Blofeld running an allergy clinic in the Swiss Alps that's really a way to brainwash attendees into distributing biological warfare. But that's secondary to Bond's relationship with Tracy, the spirited but troubled daughter of a mob boss. Tracy, a skilled skier as well as driver, gamely helps Bond throughout the movie, and the two marry toward the film's end. Then Blofeld and an assassin pepper their car with bullets after the ceremony, killing Tracy and leaving Bond poignantly holding her behind the shattered windshield. Connery returned as Bond in 1971's Diamonds Are Forever, which begins with him tracking down Blofeld to an underground lair where the Spectre leader prepares for plastic surgery. Bond ties Blofeld to an operating table and plunges it into a steaming mud lake, presumably avenging Tracy's death, although his late wife isn't mentioned elsewhere in the film.
"Welcome to hell, Blofeld."
As Bond investigates who is stealing huge quantities of diamonds, he learns that the Blofeld in the lair was actually a double for the real Blofeld, currently hanging out in Las Vegas under the guise of multimillionaire Willard White. With the help of conniving jewel smuggler Tiffany Case, Bond figures out that the diamonds are powering a space satellite and laser aimed at nuclear installations around the world. They stop the destruction, of course, although Tiffany wonders if there's any way to get those sparklers back to Earth. Roger Moore took over as 007 in 1973's Live and Let Die. Moore definitely brought a lighter touch to Bond, but this film's blaxploitation influences haven't aged well.
"Well, you just keep on the tail of that jukebox and there's an extra 20 in it for you."
"Hey, man, for $20, I'll take you to a Ku Klux Klan cookout."
The plot is Bond checking out a heroin operation controlled by a Caribbean dictator and a gangster, both of whom are actually the same person in disguise. There's a lengthy motorboat chase, a wince-inducing southern sheriff, alligators, voodoo, and some duplicitous consent with the film's women. Blaxploitation actress Gloria Hendry playing a field agent, and the tarot reader Solitaire. Moore's next Bond film, 1974's The Man with the Golden Gun, finds himself the target of Francisco Scaramanga, the world's most expensive assassin who kills with a single shot from a specialized weapon. Bond also delves into the work of a scientist wanting to harness the sun's power to solve the energy crisis. When M calls him off that mission for his safety, Bond ignores him, learning that Scaramanga is after not just Bond as a trophy, but the solar technology as well. With Spectre seemingly gone, the Bond films of the 1970s into the 1990s focused more on Cold War antagonists. The Spy Who Loved Me from 1977 does that with the cheekiness and excess of the Moore era, but for some reason, it all works. When British and Soviet nuclear submarines vanish, Bond follows a lead to Cairo, where he runs across Russian Major Anya Amosova working the case from the Soviet end. The two form a tenuous alliance to defeat wealthy shipping entrepreneur Carl Stromberg, who wants the submarines to launch Armageddon so he can create a new civilization beneath the sea. Stromberg likes sharks that devour enemies and has a metal-toothed henchman named Jaws. For all its flash, the film also has a notable callback to Bond's late wife, Tracy.
Many lady friends, but married only once. Wife killed.
All right, you've made your point.
Blame the success of Star Wars for launching Bond into space with 1979's Moonraker, a film that copies the basic plot of The Spy Who Loved Me, with that film's henchman, Jaws, now working for a different megalomaniac who wants to kill people and start over fresh. This time, Hugo Drax, a supplier of space shuttles to the US government, makes off with a shuttle to transport a new master race to his space station. It's not enough to leave Earth behind, though. Drax also has concocted a lethal toxin to kill the not-so-worthy humans trapped on the planet. The film includes a wild chase through Venice where a gondola becomes a hovercraft and a full-on laser battle in space. Bond also gets a hand from one of the smarter women of the Moore era, an astronaut and CIA agent with the eye-rolling name of Holly Goodhead. At least she can pilot a shuttle. Bond went more down to earth for 1981's For Your Eyes Only. The agent searched the Mediterranean for a missing British ship equipped with a weapons encryption device, meeting Melina Havelock, a crossbow-wielding woman whose parents worked for the British government. Her quest for revenge against whoever killed them dovetails with a secret KGB agent, Christatos, and a Greek smuggler. The film includes realistic action scenes both underwater and during a mountain climbing climax. But first, it closes the book on Spectre. In the opening moments, as Bond visits the grave of his late wife Tracy, a helicopter arrives to whisk him back to MI6. Once in the air, a surge of electricity through the headset kills the pilot, and Blofeld, now using a wheelchair, takes control of the craft from the ground. The agent manages to rip out cables connecting Blofeld's remote control, then flies after his one-time nemesis, scooping up the wheelchair on one of the chopper's skids and dropping him down a smokestack. For Moore's final two Bond outings, the agent again dealt with Cold War machinations. In 1983's Octopussy, Bond becomes involved with a jewelry smuggler and circus owner who gives the film its title. She's in league with exiled Afghan prince Kamal Khan, who's actually using her circus operation to stage a nuclear accident with a rogue Soviet general. There are acrobatic thieves, a hunt in India that's an homage to the short story The Most Dangerous Game, and disguises for Bond that include an ape costume and a clown suit. Moore hung up his Walther PPK after 1985's A View to a Kill, which pitted Bond against industrialist Max Zorin, a psychopath thanks to failed Soviet steroid experiments. Zorin has a striking henchwoman named Mayday, and designs on destroying Silicon Valley through an earthquake so he can control the microchip market. Naturally, a San Francisco geologist helps Bond disrupt Zorin's plans, resulting in a showdown atop the landmark Golden Gate Bridge. Royal Shakespeare Company actor Timothy Dalton starred as Bond in 1987's The Living Daylights. As The Guardian noted, his more nuanced and complex interpretation hewed closer to Fleming's novels, but perplexed fans accustomed to the quippy Moore years. Dalton is introduced during a training exercise at the Rock of Gibraltar, where an assassin picks off several agents until the film reveals the new 007. Defecting KGB General Georgi Kozkov says his former superior has revived a spy assassination program. But Bond later learns that Kozkov is in league with an American arms dealer and wants the man dead for business reasons. Because of the AIDS epidemic, Bond is a one-woman man this time around, forging a romance with Kara Mulovy, a cellist who had been Kozkov's girlfriend. Dalton's follow-up, 1989's License to Kill, finds Bond on a cold-blooded personal crusade against a drug dealer whose men leave Felix Leiter for dead and kill his bride, Della. Before her death, Della wonders why their friend James hasn't found a steady sweetheart, and Felix briefly explains that he was once married. Because of legal issues, Bond didn't return to theaters until 1995's GoldenEye, which starred Pierce Brosnan after Dalton resigned. The film starts about a decade before the present day, with Bond on a job with fellow 00 agent and friend Alec Trevelyan, who seemingly dies. Of course, events in Bond's life are rarely what they appear, and Bond later learns that Alec is alive and leading a crime syndicate. He seeks a satellite-based electromagnetic pulse weapon known as GoldenEye. The filmmakers attempted to update Bond for modern audiences by giving him a female M who criticizes him.
I think you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur, a relic of the Cold War.
But some Bond things never change. They also gave Alec a leggy accomplice, Xenia Onatopp, who likes to crush victims between her thighs. Bond gets some assistance from a CIA contact who disconcertingly calls Bond Jimbo, as well as Natalia, a Russian computer programmer who flirts with getting Bond to settle down. Brosnan's second outing, 1997's Tomorrow Never Dies, explores more of Bond's past by introducing a former girlfriend, Paris, now married to Elliot Carver, a tabloid media mogul. Carver draws MI6's attention after a spurious signal from one of his company's communication satellites occurs at the same time a British warship sinks in Chinese waters. Paris helps Bond infiltrate her husband's headquarters for old time's sake, for which Carver has her killed. Carver has a more unusual scheme for a Bond villain. He wants to secure exclusive broadcasting rights in China in exchange for starting a war between the British and the Chinese. Fortunately, Bond finds an ally in Wei Lin, a Chinese agent who can handle herself. 1999's The World Is Not Enough packed an impressive twist. At M's request, Bond retrieves money from a Swiss banker for British oil tycoon Sir Robert King, a particular sum that turns out to be treated with an explosive. Bond deduces that someone wanted to send a message by killing King through the cash because King's daughter Electra had recently been ransomed for the same amount of money. Although he presumes that the terrorist who kidnapped Electra is responsible, King's killer turns out to be Electra herself. She's developed feelings for her kidnapper, and the two want to detonate a nuclear explosion in Istanbul, leaving the King pipeline the only viable route for extracting petroleum from that region. Along to defuse the situation is a nuclear physicist with the eye-roll-inducing name of Dr. Christmas Jones. Brosnan's tenure as Bond finished in 2002's Die Another Day. Released the same year as the 40th anniversary of Dr. No, the film pays homage in some ways to other previous Bond films and Fleming's novels. One such nod? Having Bond pick up the book A Field Guide to Birds of the West Indies, whose author, James Bond, inspired the name of Fleming's famous spy. The plot mirrors some elements of previous entries with an adversary whom Bond thought was dead, assuming a new identity to build a space laser out of diamonds. NSA agent Jinx Johnson teams up with Bond in a story that becomes more fantastical than some fans liked. Bond surfs through an iceberg tsunami, there's an ice palace, and the Aston Martin Vanquish becomes invisible. Although he felt shocked over being replaced at first, Brosnan in 2020 said he has, quote, no regret over his 007 days, telling The Guardian, Bond is the gift that keeps giving and has allowed me to have a wonderful career. Once you're branded as a Bond, it's with you forever. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Looper videos about your favorite iconic film franchises are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.